If I was an astronaut, I'd be floating in midair, and a broken heart would just belong to someone else down there. I would be the center of my lonely universe, but I'm only human, and I'm crashing down to Earth. I'm up in space now. Man, I searched about the universe, been down some black holes. There's nothing but space, man. And I wanna go home. If I was an astronaut, I'd speak to satellites. My navigation systems search for other life, but I'd be up and thinking about what I left behind, cause I'm only human with the real world on my mind. I'm up in space now, up in space now. I've searched around the universe, been down some black holes, there's nothing but space, man. And I wanna go home. Gravity keeps pulling me down. As long as you're on the ground, I'll stick around. Stick around. I'll stick around. I'm up in space now. Up in space now. I've searched around the universe, been down some black holes, there's nothing but space, man. A been down some black holes, nothing but space, man. And I wanna go home.
Pour la première fois en France, Steve Pichers.
I can't believe it's
wasted away. And now the end is near, and so I face my burden. You can't, I'm not the will. I'll stay my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, and found wounded, and left behind me, and more, but more than this, I learned my way.
I'd like to thank Sid Vicious for opening the show. Sid Vicious from the Sex Pistols. I saw some people come and go on that. Like, I don't know what to think about this. Yeah, that's classic. I found that on YouTube. Actually, I should look up the exact artist to give them the YouTube channel that it had uploaded it. I don't think it was. I don't think. Oh, how do you like my party light? I have these little flashing. See, now it's red. Now it's green. I don't know. I'm feeling kind of festive. But I saw this documentary on Sid and Nancy that was really interesting. It was mostly from the point of view of Nancy. But then I found this archived version of My Way by Sid Vicious. There's another, you're saying something, it's like a club. Yeah, I thought maybe I'd have like a party atmosphere. I'm gonna keep it going this way because, you know, I realize that some people might actually, I don't want to cause anybody to have a seizure or something, but I have this light right here, the cam thing. Anyway, I found it, and I'm going to go to my YouTube and my history really quick so I can quote the person. I'll make sure that I have it in the description. Obviously, it's not the original. I mean, this person, it's not their original material. This is probably almost fair use, you know what I mean? An archive, but the person who did, I'm going to do a screen share on it and then give them credit because you can't find it anywhere. This is the only place that I could find this particular footage of him doing My Way. And Paul Anka actually said that he thought that his version of it was was the most passionate and almost like true to the lyrics. The channel is Louis Asenjo, and I'm going to go ahead and put that in the chat. I'm always, you know, it's important to plug other people and channels that you appreciate, you know, like share the love, right? But I just thought that was just so fun. And then, of course, the movie, I think that was like one of Gary Oldman's, I'm going to change the light here. Okay, no, wait. Oh, no, no, come on. Okay, that's good, right? I think it was one of Gary Oldman's breakthrough roles was playing Sid Vicious, and he does a rendition of that. And, of course, the movie does an artistic different kind of take on that particular footage. But that's real punk rock. I want to let the younger generations know out there that this is what grandma and grandpa used to do. You know, like, I mean, this is real anarchy, you know, like going against the system. when I was in high school, college, in college, it was punk rock. That was when punk rock was real and, you know, Sid Vicious and the whole, well, you know, punk rock basically started in England, right? So shout out to you UK people. And by the way, I also want to mention that I opened with Sam Ryder. He performed, that is the Queen's Jubilee version on Spotify. Sam Ryder, when I saw him, I go, wow, what song is this? And I thought Spaceman would be perfect for, you know, people that, because we talk about UFO stuff here, right? We're going to talk about James Casbolt today. I did a little more research, and I want to update on a couple things on him. Also, but before I get to that, I want you guys to know, oh, I'm drinking kombucha. Mm-hmm. I'm not just doing coffee today. Do you guys drink kombucha? Or, you know, do you drink those kind of things? Anyway, I do. I don't know. I think they're healthy, but who knows, right? Courtney Love, okay, Mark McFarland says, Courtney Love strives to be Nancy. Yeah, I can see that. I totally see that. And I think Courtney Love was also in the movie. She played a part. And I think they might even have met at some point. We should look that up, actually. Mario Taco says, nah, I'm into Anarchy Land. I'm young and I love punk rock. Yay! And you're young! Yay, thank you for being young and watching my channel. You know what? I looked at my stats recently. You know, you want to see how you're doing or who's watching or why, what demographic. And there's the male female gender. Apparently my male audience has been dwindling. And I thought, oh no, but then I thought with everything changing, you know, like binary, everything else, like, why do we even have to worry about what gender is watching your channel? You know, it's like, you know, maybe YouTube should, or the demographic people should think about, you know, changing that, but you know that they're not. But my audience is getting younger. And so that made me happy to see that there were some young people that were actually tuning in. So that's cool. So, and also I want to thank the new subscribers that have begun to join my channel. So thank you. Okay, I want to say something else that's going on. Should they, glasses, no glasses? All right. So I want to talk about something else. I actually did a feature article on my blog of Stephen Cambion, and I want to show you a screenshot of it really quick, and then I'm going to put it in the chat, and then when I do the description later, I'll make sure that I add this to it. So, hold on. Let me bring it up, and I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'm going to kind of show you what it looks like. I do have a Not My Rabbit Hole blog, and you know what? Just to put it out there, if you want to support me, my blog is monetized. My YouTube channel is not monetized yet because I don't have 1,000 people, but if you want to help me out to get to 1,000 so I can get monetized and do super chats, then please like my channel and, you know, subscribe and come aboard. But here on my, I do have Google's AdSense on my blog, and let me, you know what, maybe I'll just take myself out of here and show the whole thing. There's a few things I need to do. These posts don't have videos anymore, so I got to fix that. But this article that I did a feature article. It was the final in my journalism class. And we were to do a profile feature article on somebody. And I did choose to do Stephen Cambion. I've shared it on social media, and it has been getting quite a bit of positive feedback. But I want to let you guys know about it, too. And so I'll just show you the pictures that are part of it, you know, on the blog visually. And by the way, I got an A on this. And I'm going to do more feature articles on people that are in the UFO media. I want to do write-ups and other people, too, because after this, my friend Jason Stewart, who is a comedian, I'm going to do a whole feature profile on him as well. I think this might be an interest. I think people might want to, you know, have things. So I titled it The Truth Seeker, a man in his YouTube channel. And I'll just read a little bit of it. Nestled in the niche of the UFO conspiracy media is a show called Truth Seekers. Every live stream starts with scantily clad dancing girls and gray aliens, a perfect hook for the sex-starved science fiction nerd. He begins each show with a line, greetings and salutations. He sits behind a desk with goth black hair and a pair of sunglasses as a cosmic blue background swirls around him. Stephen Cambion is one of the many YouTube content providers who specializes in the topic of UFOlogy. A nemesis describes him as looking like Adam Sandler when he played Satan in the movie Little Nicky. Spooky, a former producer of Truth Seeker, says, I work with Stephen because he covers the bullshit in the field. Cambion is known for his distinctive and infectious laugh, and he often throws in puppets and comedy parodies and eccentric guests into his broadcast. One of the most eccentric guests was the late John McAfee. Cambion described McAfee as the super famous guy that would call him in the middle of the night while running from the law. Having been what he calls a UFO experiencer himself since childhood, Cambion not only seeks the truth in the existence of UFOs, but he also debunks the phony UFOologists and New Age scammers. Part of the formula of Truth Seekers is to trust but verify. Cambion continues, okay, you had this really crazy experience. Love to hear about it. I still need to verify a few things. Is their education real? Did they really work where they say they worked? People manufacture things to bolster their story, making them seem more credible. I became aware of Truth Seekers when a friend of mine shared a video of him because we were both debunking the same New Age scammer who was peddling an essential oil remedy for COVID-19. Since that day, I've been a guest on Truth Seekers several times, joined several roundtable discussions, and even co-hosted the 400th live stream celebration. And then it goes on. And, you know, he describes where he grew up, you know, his show, his interview with John McAfee. And what I like about his interview with John McAfee is this part where he describes, Cambion described John McAfee as an absent-minded professor, a genius kind of guy who would call in the wee hours of the morning from a satellite phone in a Faraday cage. And there's some funny stuff in it. You know, I included our actual bits of our own conversation when I was doing the interview. And I think it has a funny line at the end of the piece. So I want to share this with you. Here, I'm gonna put it in the chat, and please RSS me. I'm gonna be doing other articles and stuff like that about some of the things that I talk about here on my channel. That the whole purpose of that was to kind of co-hybrid everything. So that is the link there. And you know, if you notice too that I do have a podcast on Spotify, Apple Podcasts. I'm also on Google Play. in different areas. Some of my stuff is audio on Spotify. It is video if I've uploaded a video there. And you can see where my RSS feed from my podcast automatically goes up to my blog. So like, for example, you could see the YouTube frenzy, the YouTube media frenzy over a missing little girl named Summer Wells. I did do a short version of that podcast, a clip of it. But if you want to listen to the whole podcast, you can find it here at notmyrabbithole.com too. You can just click onto the link. Also, a James Casbolt Part 2, Not My Rabbit Hole Analysis with Tere Joyce. I uploaded that video here. And you can also listen to the audio version on Apple Podcasts and the other ones. But the Spotify has actual video. So this version, I edited out the things that were not part of talking about James Casbolt. So it's a more condensed video than the live stream. And so I just want you guys to be aware of that. This is another place that you can see some other type of work other than these live streams or videos that I do on YouTube. Okay. Anyway, enough about that. All right. One of the things that I wanted to talk about in terms of James Casbolt was that Can sent me a link, a clip of James Casbolt on Miles Johnston's show. I'm not going to play that part. I'm just going to give you the setup of what I looked into. And he talked about bulletproof skin. Or skin, yeah, that was able to stop a bullet from striking you. And there's a part where Miles Johnston says, oh, well, is this organic material? Is this blank, blank, blank? And, James says, yes, it is organic. It is woven into the body and all this kind of stuff. And I thought, wow, that really sounds really outlandish. And in it, there was a screenshot of an article about the bulletproof material. It was like titled "Thin Bulletproof Material," and I did look into that. I looked into a couple of things that I want to share with you, and I think that you might find this somewhat interesting because I did find it interesting, and that therefore I'm talking about it right now, right? So. I'm going to go, let me go to my, hold on. Let me go to my, shoot, what's going on here? Hold on. Cause I had the articles, saved in a specific place. I'm like, okay, see proof. Okay, here it is. All right. Okay, I didn't click hard enough. All right, this is in a publication called The Week, but it's in all kinds of different publications. So, the bulletproof super material that's paper thin, a new polymer composite, can absorb the impact from high velocity projectiles. Hold on. Something glitchy happened there. If researchers from Rice University and MIT have their way, the super soldier of the future will be outfitted in razor-thin armor that's impervious to bullets. The team of the mechanical engineers and materials scientists have developed a special ballistics material that's just 20 nanometers thick. A water molecule is just 1 nanometer wide. And can stop a deadly projectile in its tracks. The material, a structured polymer composite made of alternating rubbery and glassy layers, can absorb the kinetic energy from high impact assaults with startling efficiency. During tests, researchers blasted it with tiny glass beads that simulated the impact from a 9mm bullet. The ultra-thin layers didn't just halt a projectile in its path, but it sealed up around the embedded bead. And then it goes on, and I will make sure that I share this with you too in the chat, and that I also include it in the description after I do the show. Okay, so there it is, with the bulletproof skin thin material. And then I thought, okay, all right, so I don't think anybody really right now is publicly, they haven't stated that that's been added to the police force or DEA or FBI or CIA, right? And again, I know, and it is a possibility that maybe they're just not telling us that they're doing it. But then I thought about, like, okay, James Casbolt said in the video that it was like an organic material that was able, it had life to it. And so I looked up that too. And I want to share that with you as well. So let me pull it up here. Wait. Where did I put it at? I don't, that's not it. Hold on. Okay, here, I probably put it, no, that's the Ezra Miller thing. Sorry. Well, you know what? I'm gonna look for it, because I searched it, and here, organic bulletproof skin, and there's a few things, and okay, so here, and there's, you know what? Let me show you how many things are on the internet about it. Just a second. All right. Scientists to engineer a human with bulletproof skin. And this was November 17th, 2020. I'm going to click on that one. Bulletproof skin made from spider silk, human tissue. June 30th, 2012. So, you know, you can go back to 2012. So let's look at those articles. Let's look at the 2012 one. Okay. The World. Bulletproof skin made from spider silk human tissue. Oh, let me make sure you guys can see that. Okay, you can. Great. A new tissue made of human skin cells and spider silk appears to be able to stop a speeding bullet. The bulletproof skin is the result of a collaboration between artist Jailia Asadi and scientists and technicians in America, South Korea, Germany, and the Netherlands. More from the Global Post, scientists create silkworm spider hybrid that spins super strong silk. The inspiration for the project, named 2.6G320M/S after the weight and speed of a bullet, standard bullet vests are required to withstand, came from Genghis Khan. Asadi explains on her website, the legendary emperor is said to have issued his horsemen with silk vests. As an arrow hitting silk does not break, but ends up embedded in the flesh wrapped in the silk. Spider silk is far stronger than the silkworm fibers that most commonly make up manufactured silk. And indeed, when Kevlar, the synthetic material currently used to make bulletproof vests, scientists have long been investigating the possibility of producing an artificial fiber with the same properties, as U.S. Army researcher Stephen Fossey told New Science in 1992. Stephen Fossey, one of the researchers at Natick Army Research Center, explains that Kevlar, the DuPont flat fiber, can elongate up to 4% before breaking, while spider silks can stretch by as much as 15% before breaking. Silk, therefore, absorbs much more kinetic energy from a bullet for example, without the vest failing. Since then, scientists have been able to produce hybrid silk fibers by transplanting spider genes into silkworms. Wow. And even goats. Asadi decided to take those developments a step further by implanting the reinforced silk into layers of human cells in order to explore what it would be like to create a bulletproof human. According to New Scientist, the spider silk was spun at Utah State University in the U.S., reeled into thread in South Korea, woven in Germany, and sandwiched between layers of bioengineered skin cells at the Leiden University Medical Center in the Netherlands. All right, so it's real. To what extent it's being used comes into question. And also, I want to read this one, the tree hugger. Hold on. Yeah, I think it's fascinating. Yeah. So let me go to the other one. Hold on. Yeah. Here it is. Okay. Scientists to engineer a human with bulletproof skin. The story is part of Tree Hugger's new archive. Peter Parker originally got his superhuman powers after being bitten by a radioactive spider. Now, as if inspired by a comic book, scientists working with the Forensic Genomics Consortium in the Netherlands want to mix the genomes of spiders and humans to create, though not quite, a real-life Spider-Man. A superhuman with silk-like bulletproof skin, according to the Daily Mail. It sounds unbelievable, but the research is already well underway. The project is being called 2.6 grams, 32M/S, after the weight and the velocity of a .22 caliber long rifle bullet from which the genetically modified human skin could presumably withstand a blast. So why spiders? The key to the technology is the protein that makes spider silk. It turns out that spider silk, when spun out and weaved properly, can be made into a material that is not just bulletproof, but 10 times stronger than steel. Wow. Amazing. The idea is to replace our keratin, the protein that makes up human skin, with a modified version of the protein in spider milk. Imagine placing keratin, the protein responsible for the toughness of the human skin, with the spider silk protein, said Jalea Asadi, one of the Dutch researchers behind the project. So, do you guys want to watch, I don't know if we can watch this video without getting hit for it. I want to be careful. All right, so I'm going to put this also in the chat if you want to study on this further. And also, hopefully I can do that. I'll put it in the description of this video live stream after the show. What do you guys think about that? First of all, what do you think about hybriding an insect, what an insect makes into the human skin? What do you think about that? I'm gonna put that out there. Whoever might be in the chat. I'm interested, or even if you don't put something in the chat right now and you watch this video later, please leave it in the comment. I'm curious. I mean, is this a bad thing to be, basically you're kind of mixing an insect DNA with a human DNA. And then what happens when the human reproduces? Like, isn't this basically, could it potentially change the genetics of the human race? And should scientists have the power to do something like that? Like, where does this go to in terms of ethics is my question. And in a way, it does validate what James Casbolt was saying, because they've known this since 2020. I mean, these articles, so this one that I just read was 2020, but the other one was 2012. That's 10 years ago. Like, what has happened in terms of like 10 years in the future? Okay. Like, Mark McFarlane, I think it's dangerous to be tinkering with our DNA. Mario Taco says they do experiments on hybridized stuff. I know that from some guys checking about chimeras on Netherland. Yeah, it really validates the possibility that this is real. That part of this is real. That we can't just sit back and go, okay, everything that every super soldier says is just bullshit. Like, there, if you see that there's a possibility, how do we know that things haven't been used in intelligence or in programs that most people, you know, are not privy to, unless you have people talking about that they did these kind of things, right? Like, I just, again, and I know I could get crap for this, right? I'm kind of like in between everything. Like, I'm not a disbeliever of the possibility that these things don't exist, that psychics aren't used for warfare, that there's nothing happening in the astral plane, right? But what I question is the people that are actually on YouTube talking about it, do they really have the abilities that they say they do? Or did they just decide to like, hey, this is an easy way for me to get followers and make money, so let me pretend that I'm this, right? Right? And I'm going to just like come out and say it. Hi, Kate Schneider. I just saw you. yeah, I'm talking about bulletproof skin. There's an element of truth in every lie. Well, yeah. I mean, isn't that what the 17th letter of the alphabet did? Like, it took some topics that we were talking about, which really started in the UFO community. Which also pretty much started on those channels in some ways, you know, started with what James Casbolt and Max Spears were talking about. I'm not talking about like, oh, you know, I have bulletproof skin and, you know, Max shot me in the head and I lived the next day and they rejuvenated my body and stuff like that. Like that to me is hard to believe. Like, you're like, nah, you didn't get shot in the head. All right. Now, here's another thing. Are people instructed, if you're doing media, because I think media has a lot more power than people realize. Like, I just had somebody try to hack my Facebook page in the wee hours of the morning, because I got a message from Facebook and it said, if you want to change your password, here's the code to get in. And if you didn't want to change it, then let us know. And I let them know. I was sleeping at 4:45 in the morning. I wasn't like trying to change my password on my Facebook page. And I thought, wow, now is that just some random Indian, not Indian, I didn't mean to say it that way. Excuse me. Is there just some, did this happen in some other country? Like, you know, like in India, you know, the people in India, you're getting hacked, or there's some, you know, some other area in the world, you know, trying to get your information to take your identity away from you. Or is somebody in this community, somebody who doesn't like what I'm saying on my podcast, somebody who has already been rumored for hacking people's YouTube channels, excuse me, Sippy, all right, right? By Lionel Royale saying that she hacked my YouTube channel and took it down and then uploaded videos that would have incriminated him to use blackmail on him when he didn't do what she wanted her to do. Because that's exactly what happened. Like, if I know that I was communicating with her on Facebook and that she has the capability of like hacking somebody's YouTube channel, or knows people that have the capability of hacking somebody's YouTube channel, then who's to say that somebody's pounding on the door out there, that it's not coming from that area? I've already gotten attacked. I've already gotten things happen. Who's to say that any one of these people out here that have been trolling me, Lee Veltman or whomever, whatever you might be connected to, right? Who's to say not any one of you are trying to like hack my Facebook account? I don't know for sure, but it's awful coincidental in some ways, being that there are like right now, here's what I think. I think that everything's being revealed. You know, why I like to do my channel is because I'm searching for what the truth is. I'm fascinated by what the possibilities of things are. I'd like to know if there's extraterrestrial life and what is happening. Like, what is like life on this planet? Like, what is this all about? And I don't know about you guys, but you know, I feel like we all of a sudden, like we went into this other trajectory and we're like living a science fiction nightmare in some ways. I'm like, what the hell is happening? And you know what? If you've been following this type of media for a while, like I have too, like I started watching stuff maybe in 2009, 10, 11, up to 12, and then boom, boom, boom. And then I became a part of this media talking about these types of subjects when, in fact, in the past, I had no background in it really. It was just that I became fascinated by the possibility that we are not alone on this planet. But once I got into that media, and I'm going to be really honest with you, I wasn't planning on to talk like this to you guys. You know, I have things that I want to show you. I had a title. I have a direction, right? But when I first started coming to this media, I was really naive. I believed a lot of things. I believed like almost everything that everybody said almost. Like I did follow David Wilcock. Like I did, you know, get into like, look, I believed that there were children underneath the Getty Museum for a while. Well, I was actually dating the guy. And it could be him. You know, I just came out on Facebook and I said, you know what? Because people are getting off on Stephen D. Kelly for a second. And the realization, like, I title my blog Not My Rabbit Hole. This show's called Not My Rabbit Hole because this is not my rabbit hole. Like the whole going down the rabbit hole, the whole red pill shit, red pill nation, red pill that, I'm in the matrix. All that stuff got caught up in a lingo of disinformation with real information. And then it was propaganda that was used in American politics. So yeah, maybe there's people trying to hack my Facebook account. Huh? Maybe? Because I just said it. Like I just said what I think is actually going. And when I name, like if you look at my blog, Not My Rabbit Hole, Beyond the Red Pill, go beyond the red pill, people. You know, there's a level of deception that has taken place in this media. The very people that we've been looking at, you know, and really believing that even that is like the answer to what spirituality is and what is real in the world. Like, what is God? Who is God? Is it God or is it prime creator? Is it one and the same? Jesus, the planets, Maitreya, whatever, like the Galactic Federation of Light, the Palladians. Are there higher beings more intelligent than us, more spiritually evolved? Is the ascension real? Is the rapture real? What is happening to us right now? I have that curiosity. That's why I'm here. That's why I watched, right? Like, I'm not here to just like troll people and say, oh, you're a phony, you're a phony, you're a phony, you're a phony. But if you're a phony, somebody has to say it. Because you're not telling the truth. And you're trying to take advantage of people. Right? I mean, we have to be honest. Like, if you're going to speak to people, like, if I'm going to waste my time making videos or doing live streams, then I'm going to tell you what I think is the truth. I could be wrong. I was wrong before. I was wrong before. But it's okay to be wrong. And then realize it. And then do something to correct it. And admit, you know what? I believe this was true. And I realize it isn't. And I don't even think that we have, as a collective, I don't even think that we have decided on what the truth is. That's why we're all doing this, right? That's why we're all looking around, like, what's happening? Is something happening to children? Is this going on? Is Trump going to run again? Who's Simon Parks, you know? Is his daddy really an arachnophobia? Did Randy Kramer really go to Mars and then grow an arm? You know, some of these people know. They have drug addictions. They speak well. They act well. They can tell a good story. You want to believe it, and it's not real. And I'll tell you something else. The disclosure we get may not even be real. Because remember when Wernher von Braun, Carol Rosen, you know, you can go look it up. Like, she's even said that he said that, you know, one of the last things that they're going to do to bring in the NWO, I don't know if that's exactly NWO, was to do fake alien disclosure and a threat. So which people in this UFO community do you think is really talking about the truth? Or are they just, they don't care who they put on in front of a camera? I mean, yes, you can put people in front of a camera. You can have guests that you don't believe in, that you think are scammers, if you're still giving that objective point of view on that person and you're not just like promoting them on your shows when you do conventions and conferences and talk about it as if it's actually a true narrative. So, what more of a disservice can you do to people than that? That's what I think. Like, if you have the ability to host a show and speak to people and speak your mind or tell jokes or write a screenplay or be a social media influencer, you know, it like getting back to Spider-Man and Peter Parker, it's like with great power, there's great responsibility. And I am seeing people here in this media lacking on their responsibility as to what has integrity and real research. Yeah, baby. Woo! I didn't know I had that fight in me today. Mark McFarlane, I believe that you believe, so let's all believe together. Why do birds sing? Okay. I'm sure there's so much disinformation into the topic for sure after looking at that stuff for years. Yeah. Well, okay. So let's move on. Two, Lauren Pritchard, right? I also want to show a reaction I think that Lauren Pritchard had to doing the James Casbolt Part 2 show. And, what I'll probably do is maybe do the end screen credits and have the James Casbolt Part 2 show added to it and the Part 1. I think it was a Part 1. It was a Part 1 show. Excuse me. Where, we analyzed, right? His speech, I think, was it at the barge? First time speaking, but the last time, I believe. Well, after that, Lauren goes on her channel and says, oh, I watched the tinfoil man's, version of one of, James Casbolt's things. And when I was analyzing it, James Casbolt talks about sacrifices to Moloch and Michael Aquino and, hey, everybody, who is a super soldier is doing participating in satanic ritual abuse and they're just not admitting it. I mean, those are really heavy things to say, right? And then I did criticize Lauren Pritchard. I criticized her because it's hard to believe that she was pregnant for 5 months and then the baby was taken up to, the alien to populate the alien race. For me, it's hard to believe that, she is James Casbolt's, twin flame. And then it bothers me. Because it bothers me when people get on a YouTube camera, they're on their phone or whatever, and they're running around the border acting like they're looking for children. And then they say that they're a Christian, and then they're perpetuating this sort of like Christian righteous character, basically, in front of the camera that's hunting for children, getting arrested on buses for not wearing their mask and arguing about it, representing a demographic of people and then not be the demographic of people. To not really be a Christian, totally, really. Right? But behaving like the very worst aspect of a stereotype that someone who would be following the 17th letter of the alphabet would be stereotyped as. That's what I see Lauren Pritchard doing. And then she does a video where she says, oh, well, I'm actually Christian and a Luciferian. And that is the new religion. And her attitude is like, well, anybody else who doesn't follow that is just not enlightened, I guess, like me and my, twin flame, James Casbolt. I find it to be absolute hogwash. Now, you can say, okay, she's insane or whatever, but I'm not so sure. I mean, she's getting on stage and trying to do stand-up comedy. She has aspirations of being some type of entertainer. This is my profiling of what I think about Lauren Pritchard. Now, maybe somebody else is going to go, you want to believe it, or you watch her channel because it's a train wreck, or whatever, but it seems a bit contrived to me. And it lacks, like Peter Parker says, with great power, there's great responsibility. It lacks responsibility to what could happen to the people who may believe certain things that are part of, you know, were discussed in that propaganda, might really be a follower of Jesus Christ or a Christian, but they're not running around at the border and acting out or causing issues on buses or, you know, disseminating information about a bar and calling them witches and Luciferians. Because if you're Luciferian, where, how far away is witchcraft? Like, to me, that is the most absurd thing to say. And at the same time, you know, she can say on her channel about me that my consciousness is co-opted, that I'm AI or whatever, that there's something wrong with me. And then she spews that stuff, that it's a contradiction. It's oil and water. Anybody who really like reads the Bible or understands what things are, you have to make a choice. You can't be both. You know? So, I'm going to do the, hold on, let me do the, I'll show a little bit. Let me see the banner. Right. Okay. You know, it's like Stephen D. Kelly. I did post something to people. I said, look, man, stop sharing his lie. Now there's snuff films underneath there, the Getty. It's got the biggest whatever. I go, what are you learning? Are you running out of material? I can't believe that Mr. Jedi Warrior, who is, I know when we did the analysis of the movie, How I Infiltrated a Bizarre Conspiracy Cult about the Super Soldier Program, right? And they were at the convention in Las Vegas and the Jedi Warrior class, the person didn't show up. That was Steven. Yeah, he's telling people that he's a Jedi Warrior and that you can fight the, you know, the pedos, right? Under the Getty by using your mind in the astral plane because you're doing battle as a Jedi warrior. I say that is bullshit, Stephen. And he co-opted himself to the 17th letter of the alphabet. Big time. So, when I say I've made mistakes about what I believed in the past, I'm not kidding. But I'm beyond the red pill now, just like what it says on my blog, not my rabbit hole. This is not my rabbit hole. Oh, my God. Okay, so let's look at another person. And what does Stephen do? The Christian aspect. Liar, liar, pants on fire. All right. Let me get to my library here. Okay. Oh, they're having a cooking class. They're doing an announcement here. They're doing a cooking class over here. How to cook in our microwaves. Woo! Okay. I have to admit, though, she is entertaining. And if she is making money... Okay, let me make sure I did that right. I hope I did that right. Hold on. I had to follow up on this. I'm sorry. You know, I'm not going to apologize. And you know what? Just to help a fellow enemy out, I will share the link to her channel in my chat right now and make sure that I include this in my broadcast, in my, where am I here? Description. Okay. I just think it's important to what I'm interested in the reactions or what happens after something. Here we go.
Guys, welcome. I'm Lauren Pritchard, metaphysical advisor for the end times.
She's sorry a metaphysical. To come to hold on,
like this. I just did my hair.
I'm Lauren Pritchard, a metaphysical advisor for the end times, and she does a lot of rapture videos. All right, she's a metaphysical advisor. Does it? Do you need to have a degree? Do you have to have a certificate for that? I'm wondering.
And this couldn't wait. I was gonna put it off, but this couldn't wait. This is actually really profound. So I was just guided to listen to, if you go to the YouTube account, Tinfoil Man. And if you
I was just guided by what? By another person or consciousness? Because I happened to mirror Tinfoil Man on my channel, right? Almost the same day that the day after or the same day I did the video. I just find it coincidental. That's all.
He has playlists. And one of them is Super Soldiers, and you will find an archive of James Casbolt's material. So I was just going to watch part four.
Asked her how she how it was that she was a Christian and everything like that. And then in the video, James Casbolt says that they were doing satanic rituals with what's his name? Colonel Michael Aquino, where they cut out part of his liver and gave him an upside down crucifixion, and that all super soldiers do it. And I was going, how is it that you combine the Christianity diatribe stuff on your channel when this is what he's really all about? And I think this is what Lauren's answer is.
23, almost as if I'd never heard it before, but I had. But that's what made me go and watch it, is I thought I hadn't heard that one before. And then I was listening to Basis 23, part three. And things are starting to make a lot more sense. The stuff that he's talking about, we couldn't have understood back then.
Now, maybe this is like a different video, but I do find it interesting that she's doing it was right after.
And I'm just gonna get right to the point. Okay, with this whole like New World Order takeover, first of all, okay, there's a history of these two groups that are so powerful, they're both so equally powerful, that we'll just keep on warring forever. It's like the Michael and Lucifer war. It's like these twin brothers, they're so powerful. We'll just keep on warring forever if we don't come to a singularity of sorts. And so I do believe that Satan is the massive energy that tries to come between the two if they turn and face the common enemy, which is, just the antithesis to love and life. Then there is a new one world religion. And while obviously the rapture for the Christians in heaven, yeah, they might not want anything to do with the material world. But there's like all these like robot people that I'm like, they're pleasant and they're enjoyable. Like, I don't have to be a slave to their system. I don't like it. I feel like this life is so stupid and boring. Like, I can't believe how, I'm amazed by how people are so entertained by the material world. Like, such a, like, loveless, boring existence to me. It's like, they love it so much, you know? It's fascinating to me. And, like, while I do find them enjoyable, I would rather destroy their creation instead of having to live it, right? So, again, it's like these two groups.
And what does that mean? Like, I hate it. I, Lauren, hate it so much here. I'm so bored with everything that's in the material world that I'd rather destroy their creation than live in it. And so that's almost psychotic, really. Like, I want to destroy everything else that's alive, basically, because I'm dissatisfied with it. I don't give a shit about anybody else who might have a different timeline or life path experience, but you want to take that all away from that person? That's rather, that sounds like, what does that sound like? That sounds like what we call the Illuminati, basically, or people that just don't care about other people. And yet you're going to give metaphysical advice on what's happening during this, during the rapture.
Groups that are like equally powerful, you know, the Christian, like I would rather destroy them. If I had to live in that any longer, I would rather destroy them. But then I think about it, that's like a waste. Like that's such a waste of resources that it can't, it might not be the final solution. So there's probably a small remnant of the material world that is left for, it's a new heaven and a new earth. So like the Christians can go to heaven.
I mean, I almost feel like she's actually a Luciferian and she's just mocking Christianity. I wonder about that sometimes too, because she's gonna admit it here in a minute.
The new heaven. And then like, you know, just these kind of like robotic Tesla, Elon people can like stay like a new earth. And I do think, because I got a scripture, Ephesians 2, it's that all things come together through Christ. And so in these bases videos, Michael was talking about how
that all things come together through Christ. Yeah, if you are with Christ, it's not like all things that are like robotic people and the infusion of the two planes and they're going to be enlightened too. Like it doesn't, there's nothing in the Bible like that. Like, oh, the sin and the good all come together. And so, you know, what, we're going to be okay with our dark side or what?
How? Like there is a school of thought that like the two in one, like at some point God was one, right? So the two in one would be like the Michael and the Lucifer at some level is the same.
So Michael and see, that is a Luciferian theory. Like the whole thing about Luciferianism is that Jesus is actually Lucifer and vice versa. That is the satanic path. That is exactly what it is.
You know, this Christianity and Luciferian is like at some point the same. And then there is like a antithesis to
I want to go back to the two in one.
Like at some point God was one, right? So the two in one would be like the Michael and the Lucifer at some level is the same. And you know, this Christianity and Luciferian is like at some point the same. And then there is like a antithesis to all that, which is kind of like the over-sexualized female, the female worship that's like the squid. And then like the gay satanic men, like these gay Freemasons, these like gay robots, you know, they don't like, they're not interested in like the woman. They're just all, they want like robot girlfriends. So like, that's the common enemy. It's like the squid, the black goose squid, the whores, over-sexualized women with the hypnosis. And there goes Jerry up the stairs. You know, like just these gay Joe Rogan robots. Like that's
Joe Rogan!
Like that's the trap.
Joe Rogan's a robot too! Oh, that's so fantastic, Lauren. Oh, why do you hate Joe Rogan so much? Oh.
Itself out. But what do? They take the trash out. What have I been saying so much lately? I don't like communism.
Can Joe Rogan be saved too in this oneness that's coming together? Aw, really, Lauren? How sweet.
I love it because the trash has to take itself out. You know, Satan, because the trash has to take itself out. Well, Michael was saying in these videos that it's going to be
Michael, like she calls him Michael.
New world religion, and he said people will basically be saying like hail Satan, you know. And back in the day I didn't really think much of it because I trust him, and I was just like, well, I don't know. And then
back in the day, when did you actually have a conversation with James, Lauren? Back in the day, when
we're like, these people are so dumb, they're so wicked, they're so wasteful. I'm like absolutely amazed by how entertained by they are by the material world. And if I have to live in it another day, I'd rather destroy it. But obviously this other group,
if I have to live in it another day, I would destroy it. I mean, Wow, you would destroy the planet. You wouldn't just like say, hey, I'm taking myself out of here, but you would say, I'm going to destroy the entire planet with myself because that's how much I hate the planet. And she calls herself a metaphysical advisor. Listen to what she's actually saying. I'm amazed that people buy into this. I mean, or are those just bots? Or are those just people going, oh, you know, Lauren, you're so, I love you, like love and light. Everything's so great. You teach me, you know, you're, who chooses her for a metaphysical advisor? I wouldn't. I'm not.
Popularity forming. I get what I want. They get what they want, you know, love and the material, new heaven, new earth. And so what
I get what they want. They get what I want. We all get what we want because that's what it's really all about.
Like stopping us. It's like just all the riffraff, you know, these like alien entities, like nasty alien entities, these like nasty lizards, these people that just don't evolve, can't evolve.
And then she goes into the baby stuff and she tries to explain that again too. So I did put the thing in the chat. If you like her, God bless you. I mean, I just, in terms of like, what, in terms of like doing the shows about James Casbolt and then to have her come out and say this, I'm calling huge hypocrisy on it. It's not original. This is her thought and the way she's thinking is not original either. And so if you think that she's like representing like Save the Children, or she's representing, you know, I'm James Casbolt and our connection in the twin flame is even remotely part of this, like this exaltation of the super soldiers as if they would be in the position to give you spiritual knowledge. Okay, they are basically, if they say what they are, if that's even any of it's remotely true in their case, 100% when they're talking about themselves, or if they're telling partly of a truth and they're fantasizing it way out, like pretending that what they do is beyond what they actually really do, what gives them the license to give you spiritual knowledge? And they do it, and I don't know a single one of them that hasn't done it. Maybe Max, you know, I mean, he did fall into like somewhat of the new age category, but he wasn't like taking donations to heal people, and he wasn't teaching Jedi warrior classes, Stephen D. Kelly, that you don't show up to teach at. You know? So I just wanted to share that with you. Oh, you can't stand my voice? Okay, well, you know what? Then stop watching, all right? Or if you're talking about, who are you talking about? Are you talking about Lauren or are you talking about me? Okay, you're probably talking about Lauren. Sorry, I'm taking it personal. I can't tell, all right? I guess my voice can get annoying when it gets too high and I try to focus on getting it lower, so... I will work on getting my, I have to realize that when I get excited, my voice goes up and then it's like, I'm like, even I get annoyed. So, anyway, no, Lawrence. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Hi, Stormy. Yeah. I met Lauren. No, don't be sorry. I'm oversensitive sometimes, especially like because I get bashed so much. I think everything's like that after a while, and I realize it's not. So I catch myself, you know, I catch myself and realize I wasn't seeing things as they are. Like I read it again because your interpretation of it, my filter is not sometimes seeing what is. No, it gets high sometimes, but thank you. I realize it. You know, I got criticized by Deborah Director, you know, the Rose, and she's like, well, you know, you used to have this high little voice and blah, 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 and now you're like, you know, like, what's going on? You're a clone. I'm like, no, I've been working on bringing my voice down because, like, and I have really bad allergies, and so my sinuses are bothering me today. Matter of fact, I pushed the show farther because I had a sinus headache. So So when I sound nasal, I can't help it. Sorry. It's just the way it is sometimes. Okay. I'm going to look at some of your stuff, and then I want to talk about a couple more things that I think you might be aware of. But this was the, oh, thank you. Oh, that's so nice. Thank you. It's okay, Tere. It happens after the madness, but I prefer to chill out and not get annoyed easily. Yeah. It's like experiencing things in a dream. Years later, you may forget it was a dream, but the experience feels so real. That's from Mark McFarland. Oh, yes, Lauren. I don't know what to think, right? I mean, I do know what to think. I kind of suspected something was like weird, you know, like off with Lauren. Okay, I'm going to tell you what I think. And I'm not saying this is the truth, right? But sometimes I think it's all a big show. Like it's just a put on. Like it's just part of the propaganda. Like I think there's something more behind this. I think that there's certain people that have YouTube channels that have other agendas that might be nefarious. I really do. And, you know, and for example, let's talk about what the experience with Sippy Talker for me, you know, like how it came down around the Harmony Montgomery case and the Summer Wells case, you know. See, I wouldn't even known about Harmony Montgomery, that missing little girl in Boston, if it hadn't have been for Rose from Team Rose, who was on Facebook, like going off about another YouTuber named Avery Shannon, that she was, you know, stalking her and, you know, they had a hitman on her and all this kind of stuff. And I found Avery's channel. She does a true crime podcast. And then I found the Dolly Vision stuff, which, you know, that's Jimmy Jam's TV, and, you know, their entire focus is Summer Wells. And I uploaded a few videos recently. This is something I also wanted to talk about today. I uploaded a few videos. One of them was on my podcast, and it was like the media frenzy around a missing little girl named Summer Wells. And, you know, the family of this little girl's been missing. Today's the 16th, right? So this little girl's been missing since June 15th. This is Summer Wells. Okay. And there's stuff going on with Harmony Montgomery, too. And I'm going to get to that in a second. Summer Wells, the family, they did put information out on social media because they thought that social media would help finding their daughter. But what's happened is the social media has made an entire circus. They've been harassed. They've been threatened. They had somebody show up on their property at 2:00 in the morning. He was on Dr. Phil talking about this. And then Dolly Vision makes jokes about the little girl because, like, one of the last photos that she had her head resting on some milk containers. And he's making jokes about, oh, you know, it's so hot here in my studio, blah, 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 blah. I'm sweating like little Summer Wells. I'm leaning my head against the milk cartons like Summer Wells is. And like a lot of people took offense to that. He sells t-shirts. He allows Rose, Team Rose, to be on his show and disseminate 17th letter of the alphabet kind of sentiments, like every missing child case, obviously it has to be that. It couldn't be some other situation. And even so far as to coming up with a theory that the grandmother was probably a Satanist and did it on her channel. She gets kicked out of these chat rooms. She causes all these problems. She's accusing Avery of like threatening to kill her, but in fact, it's Avery that ended up being the victim. She was the targeted person by this because I think she has a legitimate channel. But what's happening now, and I want to share this with you, and I'm really glad that this is happening because she actually has started a program they're going to start to crack down on YouTube channels doing videos on, like, on the backs of young children like that. That there's an, it's an exploitation of missing children. Like, and let me specify this. And when I talk about Rose, when I talk about Team Rose, Deborah Director, who's actually also an actress, but I don't think she's tried stand-up comedy. Come to find out, you know, Rose Blueprint 48, Rose that talks about Max Spears and talks about how she's channeling messages or that he's been cloned or something like that. That Rose is involved with the channels that are exploiting this little girl. And not only is she involved with it, but she's actually paying them. And if you look at my video that I have uploaded here about the media frenzy about Summer Wells, you can hear an excerpt where you hear her admitting that she was upset. See, here's a grown woman upset by the fact that she gets timed out in Dolly Vision's chat room and she goes off for, I did just a clip of it, but she goes off and she says, I pay the motherfucker, is what she says, quote unquote. You don't know who you're messing with. I pay him. Wow, interesting. Interesting that you're paying for media that is actually harming the family themselves. They had to have their children taken away because the CPS determined that because of the abuse on social media, that it was not a safe home for their children, for the other three boys. And that is, I say, that's the responsibility of this media, these channels. And you know what? And you don't have any shame for it. Ernie Schell, another one, who, by the way, just got arrested for meth. He was starting a nonprofit to, he says, I'm a bounty hunter and all this kind of stuff, apparently. Taking donations for a nonprofit that doesn't really exist. He doesn't have a 501c3 nonprofit license yet. And yet these people are making, Dolly Vision has t-shirts that they sell. And when I looked into this, it all happened on the Harmony Montgomery show that I did, the Super Soldier Investigations of Harmony Montgomery, because I realized that Rose had hybrided herself into two different types of medias, really. Super Soldier stuff and then this stuff, or Palladian stuff, you know, Simon Parks things, Barbara Marciniak, Anu, you know, all of those, you know, Crystals and Max Spears, and then she's over here doing this, and then she's an actress on top of that. I find that to be really interesting. To me, it's kind of like, a little circle here. And a fake profile called Crystal Rose Montgomery, which, by the way, and I asked her, I go, why is the name Crystal the same as the missing little girl Harmony Montgomery's mother? And Montgomery was the father. And that story has broke. They did the house that father, when he had custody of her, the apartment that he lived in, they took out a refrigerator, they wrapped it up in tape. There was, you know, people in hazmat suits. They're looking down the drain now. They blocked off the entire thing. They called the coroner. Like, it does not look good. It's a high profile case. It's being depicted on court TV. I did a video where CBS is talking about it, and I followed up on it because I started talking about it here on my channel because I discovered it through the whole Rose thing. And instead of Rose answering me why her name was similar, where did the Crystal Rose Montgomery come from? Well, you know, she went on her channel and told people that I was a clone and whatever. And, you know, I was a hybrid, just like Lauren Pritchard. Like, you guys do the same thing. Like, I'm pretty sure, like, you know, Stephen D. Kelly's going to say that I went to the dark side. I can hear it already. Either that or he's going to completely ignore that I'm even talking about him at all. Because that's what he does. Okay. Free has taken action, and I want to show you something. I took a snapshot of it. It's an organization that is going to work towards stopping this, and I have a JPEG or a PNG of it. I'm going to just pull it up here. All right, the state of Alabama, John H. Merrill, Secretary of State Alabama, having custody of the great principal of steel of said state, do hereby certify that pursuant to the provisions of Title 10A, Chapter 1, Article 5, Code of Alabama 1975, and upon an examination of the entity records on file in this office, the following entity name is reserved as available: AC Adults Against Child Internet Exploitation for Profit. The name reservation is for the exclusive use of Avery Shannon. So she's made, she's making a thing here. The name, she's bought the name, she's got the name. In testimony, I have here unto set my ban and affixed the great seal of the state at the Capitol in the city of Montgomery on this day. So, and then also on her channel, she had shown, well, she put that, I think she took that channel, she took it down, but she showed a press conference that was actually online where there was a woman talking about how this has to stop on social media. Over Summer Wells, over what's happening with Summer Wells. And another thing I want to say about that particular video that I did, it's here. Super Soldier Investigations of Harmony Montgomery. I showed, footage of the Boston police talking about her. And guess who was in my chat with a fake profile? Lee Veltman. That was the day that I had the incident with Steve Ronan and Lee Veltman and Angel Power Disney, who happened to show up too, which I find interesting. Like, I feel like there was drama on purpose created in my chat as a distraction while I was trying to cover that case. And then later on, I found out that Lee Veltman tried to like hybrid the Harmony and Montgomery thing to a Boston cult. Wanted to dismiss me with Jolly Bridgeburner. This is the genesis of all this. This is the beginning of everything else that I've kind of like in a way had to deal with on my channel. You know, so I want to just let you know that there's this little hot spot about this. And Harmony Montgomery was missing for 3 years. And the birth mama reported it 2 years prior and it was ignored. And the mayor's, you know, it's a big deal with DCY, you know, the Child Protective Services there. It's a big deal. It's a big mistake. And her brother got adopted by a journalist, a newscaster, I think out in DC somewhere, I think. And not Harmony. And then Harmony got placed with her father, who was not a good candidate. He had already shot his drug dealer in the face while his wife was pregnant with her. So, I mean, it's something to look at about what is happening with child services in a way. Like, how could that happen where they allowed her to be missing that long? And now we're at this point. And there's new evidence. And then Rose goes, oh, I don't care anything about Harmony Montgomery. I'm all about Summer Wells. And she patronizes Ernie Schell and everybody else on that thing. I don't understand why there's such a fixation. And there was an abuse on YouTube that is taking place. It's still taking place. You guys are still doing it. They're still doing it. All right. Another thing I want to bring up, today is we were talking about, oh, one more thing about James Casbolt. Holly said that she got a letter from him saying that he was, I guess, communicating with the Maitreya people. And she thought just logically that that's maybe where he went to. And I was watching this documentary on L. Ron Hubbard. And this is one of the last things that he wrote before he died. It was May 5th, 1980. This was released by his son, who surely died after he released this information. It's like the highest level of information that you can find if you go all the way up the ladder of Scientology. And he said something, and bring about the eventual enslavement of mankind. As you know, Siddhartha Gautama never claimed to be anything more than a man. Having caught on this operation, he postulated his own return as Maitreya. So basically what he did was, before he died, he said that he was going to come back as Maitreya, which is actually Maitreya. And I find that to be interesting because Maitreya is also associated with the Raelian society, or the Raelian, here, I'm gonna Google that really quick just to kind of look at this for a minute. Who these people really are and what they believe in. Because one thing that really fascinates me, I did Maitreya UFO. The one thing that really fascinates me is the cult and the UFO aspect of everything. One of the things that I learned about Giant Rock, you know, Giant Rock, the George Van Tassel, where, you know, he they built the Integratron based on the blueprint given by extraterrestrials, and he died like a couple weeks before it happened. And well, at Giant Rock, they had people gathering out there, the UFO community. And, you know, Ron L. Hubbard was out there. He was one of them, right? And then L. Ron Hubbard was friends with Jack Parsons and Aleister Crowley and Anton LaVey, and they tried to do the Moonchild. So, I mean, there's a whole thing to this. But Maitreya, if you look, Maitreya 12, Maitreya Crop Circles in the Age of Light, Brill, UFO Religion, Share International Maitreya for the Examination of Theological Issues as They Pertain to Extraterrestrial Intelligence. Books, Occult, Crop Circles, The Naked Truth About Raelians and Their UFO Religion. I think Maitreya is involved in this too. I thought maybe it was. These people are interesting. They do these. I actually filmed it once. They were walking in Venice Beach. They advocate being topless in public, and they think that it's offensive to make women wear tops and let men to be on the beach without it. The group congregated silently around the doors leading into the ballroom. All eyes looked toward the floor. We were 12 hours into the fast. From food, talking, technology, sex, and eye contact. So that's interesting. Yeah, I mean, you know, we could talk about this for days, right? I mean, about everything that has sprung up from the belief that extraterrestrials existed. You know, you have Shirley MacLaine, Dancing in the Light, all that stuff. Stormy says God wins. Yes. Yes, he does. I agree. It's not about God. It's about the darkness, and the darkness always loses. Oh, hey, Electro Pig. Yup, and the more people wake up to it, the greater the threat to those who have been pulling the strings for the last century or so, hence their desperate need to exterminate the useless eaters. Maitreya, the new Antichrist. You mispronounced Gulub. Just slipped her mind. Well, you know what? I think that I think this pretty much is like the end of today. It's everything that, oh, wait, I forgot Ezra Miller. Oh, one more thing. Ezra Miller, and I want to do a follow-up on Chuck Barris on the Confessions of a Dangerous Mind. Someone in my chat said that, again, I guess I'll go back into this. Chuck Barris from The Gong Show and The Dating Game, The Newlywed Game. He wrote a book called Confessions of a Dangerous Mind, where the story interweaves him being producing all these shows, and he is an assassin for the CIA at the same time. So, for example, when one of the dates had to go to Germany, the contestants went, and he goes with them because they have to have a chaperone. And while he's doing that, he's actually on an assignment for the CIA. Julia Roberts is in it, and it's directed by George Clooney. And somebody said, he eventually admitted that he didn't do it, but that's not exactly correct. Actually, he took it to his grave and never. Maybe once he said it, but for the most part. Here, let me find the article. He took it to the grave. He never really admitted to it. And there was this last part. Like I always said, that I love the last part of the movie where he says, "A man in his 60s is towards the end of his life, and they tell him, they review everything that he's done, and they give and at the end of it, the winner gets a new refrigerator." I just find that to be like, shoots himself in the head or something. There's something. Oh, God, I still screwed it up. I have to watch the movie still. Okay, so yeah, here it is. Let me find it. Chuck Barris, host of The Gong Show, who wildly claimed to be a CIA agent, dead at 87. From the boundary-pushing games to his strange claims of being a CIA assassin, Chuck Barris lived large. The book was adapted as a feature film, Confessions of a Dangerous Mind. I'm trying to find that place where he says, one of the show's primary draws was a sexual innuendo. Making whoopee. Everything was dealing with people, no right and wrong answers, and no scripts, Barris told the AV Club. He was like labeled the king of schlock, the baron of bad taste, and the Ayatollah of trashorola. That didn't show his output. He also wrote a song too. That I think made it to number one. Okay, Barris's most outlandish moment, though, came in 1982 when he wrote an autobiography announcing he had served as a contract CIA assassin during his time working in television. By that year, his shows had all begun to wind down. The Gong Show movie, which directed and starred and only stayed in theaters for 1 week. He was infuriated. Critics had harassed me for 15 years, saying I had lowered the bar of civilization. I couldn't deal with this anger, and I had to get it out of my system. So I found a hotel that had monthly rates. I thought I'd take out a month before I went back to California, and I would write it out. He emerged with Confessions of a Dangerous Mind, an unauthorized biography, which was made into a 2002 film directed by George Clooney and written by Charlie Kaufman. In it, he claims his trips to foreign destinations, supposedly to scout locations to send his game show victors, were merely a cover for him to assassinate CIA targets. A CIA spokesman flatly denied the claim. It sounds like he has been standing too close to the gong all those years, said the CIA spokesman Tom Crispell. Chuck Barris has never been employed by the CIA, and the allegation that he was a hired assassin is absurd. Though asked many times over the years if it was true, Barris told the Los Angeles Times, "I'll never answer that question." Times' Joel Stein, who seemed to believe the book to be fiction, wrote, "Barris wrote the book partly because he's a huckster. He faked a resume for NBC, peddled game shows, even though he didn't like them. And God knows what he has told his three wives. But he's fabricated his life because it might have been the best way of getting at the truth. The truth was that back then, when he was the Jerry Springer of his day, he couldn't stomach being attacked for doing nothing he considered harmless." Many point to Barris's television output as a precursor to today's reality landscape with shows like America's Got Talent and American Idol. "I think anything would have been possible without my shows," Barris told AV Club. "I think the dating game and the newlywed game began the moment for what eventually became Fear Factor, the Jerry Springer Show, Joe Millionaire, and so on." And so, I don't know, I just thought that was interesting that he said, "I'll never tell." And, you know, so is it real? Is he a huckster? What do you guys think? What do you think? It's almost like I almost want it to be real, you know, like you almost want it to be real. Yeah, but it might not be. Like the argument is that he was kind of a huckster, right? So is it all just kind of, it certainly made it into a movie, right? It made it exciting. Okay, so I want to talk about the actor Ezra Miller. He is he stars in The Flash. And there is a lot, like, I'm going to just read the Daily Beast article because it's the most up-to-date one. Now, Ezra Miller, I always thought was a, he's an interesting actor. And he also is non-binary transgender. And so he's been a Hollywood, almost like a role model of coming out and being that way. I've been watching what's been going on with him. You know, he got arrested in Hawaii. He attacked some people in the karaoke bar. He's been acting out and getting arrested and causing problems. And now there's the families that have come and they say that he has been grooming their children since they were 12 years old. And he's getting a lot of press right now. The first time I saw him there's a movie called There's Something About Kevin. And before I go, you know, I'll pull up his resume, but he's been acting since he was at least a teenager. He played There's Something About Kevin, starred him and Tilda Swinton. And it basically he plays one of those kids that goes and shoots up his entire school. Or, you know, so it's a difficult movie to watch, but his performance was quite compelling as a young man. Yeah, Ezra Miller. And you know, there are people that are saying, "Hey, how come Warner Brothers hasn't fired him yet? Like, why is the media not focusing on this? Like, there's people complaining about the media not focusing on things, right?" And I'm going to make a complaint out there. You know, like all you guys out there talking about these things, like, you know, making up stories around Summer Wells, but you're so concerned about what happens in Hollywood and, you know, what is really going on. Like, for example, Angela Parra, Disney or whatever, you know, like all these people out there are just doing this, you know, this whole, you know, these people who basically are associated with Miles Johnston going on about all these conspiracies, but you're going to ignore the fact that something's actually really happening in Hollywood. Why aren't you reporting this? Why aren't you discussing it and bringing it to the table to your own channel? I question those things. Like, for example, a lot of the guys out there that wanted to perpetuate 17th letter of the alphabet stuff just stopped talking about Ghislaine Maxwell or the trial or Jeffrey Epstein or anything that was like really a real possibility that would really lead to anything concrete about the conversations that happen in the alternative media. But this is really ongoing and it's gonna probably keep going and it's coming to a head. It's getting there. So I wanna do a screen share here on that. Okay, the Daily Beast. All right. 12-year-old granted order of protection against Ezra Miller. The Daily Beast spoke with the alleged victim, a 12-year-old non-binary child, their mother, and their neighbor, who all described the night the Flash star allegedly menaced them. And I noticed, like, I'm going to show you a lot of pictures. I'm going to go into the images because he does a lot of things with his fingers in the images, which I find like, what does that mean right there? As above, so below, is that what's going on? I don't know. On Wednesday, a mother and her 12-year-old child traveled to their local courthouse in Greenfield, Massachusetts, and were granted temporary harassment prevention order against Ezra Miller after alleging that the actor menaced their family one evening in their downstairs neighbor's home and acted inappropriately toward the non-binary youngster. The news comes on the heels of a number of other disturbing allegations that have surfaced against the 29-year-old, best known for their turn as Flash, the Flash in Justice League. Miller is also non-binary. Last week, the parents of 18-year-old environmental activist Takata Iron Eyes requested that a court issue a protective order against Miller, stating in court documents that the actor met Takata 6 years ago when they were 12 and Miller was 23, and that Ezra uses violence, intimidation, threat of violence, fear, paranoia, delusions, and drugs to hold sway over a young adolescent Takata. The parents also accused Miller of influencing Takata's decision to come out as non-binary transgender. An unverified Instagram account presumed to belong to Takata denied the claims. The court has been unable to locate Miller to serve the papers, and Miller deleted their Instagram Wednesday afternoon. Deleted the Instagram, but not before posting a series of memes mocking the authorities for their inability to find him. Creator Mia Solange took to TikTok in April to accuse Miller of being a hashtag abuser, while the actor was arrested twice in Hawaii for disorderly conduct, harassment, and allegedly throwing a chair at a woman. On top of it all, in 2020, a video went viral of Miller attacking a young female fan in Iceland, though local authorities declined to investigate the incident. This is compelling. This blew me away. In the Massachusetts case, the Daily Beast reviewed a copy of the protection order signed by a judge and spoke with the 12-year-old accuser. Their mother and another neighbor who was present, the case docket has not been posted on the court's online system. The Daily Beast also reviewed contemporaneous text messages sent by the mother and the neighbor, as well as photographs that corroborated parts of their accounts of the night in question. We are withholding names for privacy reasons. On the evening of February 2nd, the trio contend that Miller was present at the downstairs neighbor's home in Greenfield, which is located about 40 miles from the actor's ranch in Stamford, Vermont. That neighbor is in a band with Whitney Sutters, a musician who was a close friend with Miller. Miller was wearing a bulletproof vest and had no idea until later that they were armed, recalls the visiting neighbor. Well, I guess he wasn't wearing bulletproof skin though. So, hey. All right. Tensions began brewing when the mother said she mentioned doing some traveling recently with her tribe of people, leading Miller to snap at her and accuse her of cultural appropriation. Then a conversation about board games allegedly went sideways when Miller claimed that the board game Parcheesi had Rastafarian roots. The visiting neighbor, who is half black, questioned Miller as to which sect of the Rastafari movement it originated from. At this point, Ezra explodes and started screaming directly into my face, the visiting neighbor tells me, they said, you don't even know what the fuck you're talking about. What did you say to me? What did you say to me? I was very caught off guard. The visiting neighbor continues. Then they open up their jacket. They had this like big Sherpa jacket, and they open up one side of their jacket and you could see a gun. And they said, talking like that could get you in really serious trouble. This is the part that really gets me. Okay. I'm glad we're getting to this part. Next, according to the visiting neighbor, the mother and the child, Miller, focused their attention on the 11-year-old, saying, I've talked extensively with your child, and they have a lot of power to them. At one point, you're going to realize that you don't have any control over them anymore. They're an elevated being. And they would be lucky to have someone like you to guide them. Someone like me to guide them. This is the part. They're an elevated being. And they would be lucky to have someone like me to guide them. They say Miller proceeded to turn to the mother, who dresses goth, and accused her of being a witch and a vampire, repeatedly yelling at her, do you want to drink my blood? Do you? Anyway, so it goes on. I mean, and he went back to the place repeatedly. And I'm going to put that in the chat, and I will make sure that I add that in the source material of this video. I just think it's interesting, and then the whole vampire accusation, and you know, is he an asset? Like, is he MK Ultra? You know, was like because of the fact that he was a young man, and he was a minor in a major film and stuff. Here, let's look at his bio. Makes me wonder, like, what happened to him, and what happened to him, right? Like, Is this just like another fallout of what maybe goes on in Hollywood? He has so much on him right now. I bet that he's gonna get pulled from the Flash. MK Ultra is everywhere. Yeah. Yeah, Mario. MK Ultra, it seems like it's everywhere. Okay, so Ezra Matthew Miller, born September 30th, 1992. So, wow, he's born in the 90s, is an American actor. Miller's feature film debut was in After School, which they followed by starring in the drama We Need to Talk About Kevin. That's the movie that I was telling you about where he was pretty much a young man in. 2011 psychological thriller drama film directed by Lynn Ramsey from a screenplay she co-wrote with Rory Stewart Kinnear, based on the 2003 novel of the same name. Okay. And The Perks of the Wallflower, 2012. In 2015, Miller co-starred in the Stanford Prison Experiment. Oh, interesting movie. I would love to see that. But the 1971, I think I have seen it. I have to see that again. That's where they did an experiment by people mocking prison guards and prisoners, and like the actual power dynamic that took place. They had to actually call off the experiment because it went too far. And the comedy Trainwreck, Fantastic Beasts. Okay. Now, this has just recently been added. Since 2022, Miller has been the subject of several incidents relating to disorderly conduct, assault, and resulting in multiple arrests and allegations grooming underage individuals. Career. So he's born in 1992. He started acting in 2008. So he was, let's see, that would make him about 17 years old. Let's So maybe he wasn't underage when he, he might have just looked young. Yep. That's what's going on with him. And it's just interesting that this is coming out right now. Also, let's look at his images so you just kind of get a... He's interesting to me, honestly. You know, I mean, I always kind of thought that he had sort of a look about him that, you know, you want to look at. I think he's pretty, you know, attractive in a way, in his own way. See, there he is doing the hand thing. There it is again. Oh my God. See, there it is. The hands. He doesn't look happy, really. Oh, here he is at the Met Gala. Hold on. This is wild. Let me click onto that. Oh, shoot. There. There he is at the Met Gala. Can you see it? Let's see if I can enlarge that. I mean, like, come on. That is so, so Illuminati, right? Like, you can't get more Illuminati than that. And then the face mask, like the altar, you know? I mean, that's kind of how it reads to me. There isn't any shortage of crazy these days. True. MK Ultra is everywhere. Ah, Tere, there's so many secrets and occult knowledge hiding behind our eyes. Oh, yeah, I agree. I wish I could explain more. I think that if you, here's my thought. All right, I'm going to go with you on that, Mario, because I think that if you have... We have the DNA of our ancestors. So if our ancestors did it and know it, then sometimes I think it's easier to assimilate the knowledge that you, like, you read it, you understand it or whatever, because it's somewhere there's a knowingness or knowledge of it. It's your choice if you want to do it or not, right? I mean, that's the ultimate, I think that's the ultimate thing. All right, so you guys, I'm gonna get going. Like, I'm trying not to go too long. Okay, I really appreciate you guys being here, and I just kind of want to talk about my channel just really briefly. And while I'm doing that, if you do want to support me at all, you know, you want to give me a one-time, I'm accepting one-time donations to help out with my college fund as well. I am going to school. I'm in summer school coming up. I'm wanting to add more content. For example, I have my blog, and I'm going to start writing more feature articles. I did add it in the chat, the article I did on Stephen Cambion. Please do read it. That's one way of supporting me. I've got Venmo, Cash App. It's also in here too as well. And I do have a Patreon, patreon.com/notmyrabbithole. And I want you guys to know, what would you want from me that would be extra? If you wanted to participate in my Patreon, what type of special content would you like me to provide for you? And, you know, and I'm open for all ideas. You can even say it here in the chat, or you can add it in the comments. You know, I'm trying to think, like, well, what do you want? Right. I'm working towards adding more content, you know, I feel like this channel is like a development, and I think that my school is helping me to be better at what I'm doing here. And, So if you can't contribute financially at all or support in that way, then please do give my video a like, share it, help me get my numbers up so I can monetize my channel and my blog at notmyrabbithole.com is monetized. So if you do hit that and look at that, then that helps me out too as well. You can find me on Facebook at Tere Joyce. I have Not My Rabbit Hole with Tere Joyce Facebook page. Please like my page. I'm on Twitter at Tere Joyce. You can find me on Twitter. I'm also on Instagram at Tere Joyce. That's TereJoyce. You can follow me in those spots. And also I want to ask you another thing. I am going to start to upload not just on and also check out Not My Rabbit Hole podcast on Google Play, Apple Podcasts, Spotify. Videos are on Spotify. Join the RSS feed. That's another way. That is monetized. I run an advertisement on the just the listening ones. So if you listen, I get paid. So give it a listen and help me, monetize that way as well. And that's it. And so I think what I'm going to do, I did do a video, I'm starting something that I might thank you for listening to. I really appreciate it. And I want to close the show out. I'm going to go ahead and close the show out. I it's a video and I'm dancing to, where is it? Where Is the Love by Black Eyed Peas? So, and I sometimes close on this anyways, but I'll give you a visual while you're listening to it. Let me take this down for a second. The lyrics to the song mean a lot to me. And I think that it's got a good message. And, thank you, Stormy. We appreciate you as well. Thank you. And Mario, thank you. I really appreciate it. Mario says, I will try to help Terry. Okay. And then he also said something about him. He chose the dark side and I chose the light. Yeah, he did. And then he talks about being a wizard and stuff. Because I'm a blah, 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 known as a blank, blank wizard. I'm like, oh, my goodness. My uncle was a black magician. That's all. And I learned many things. Well, maybe you said, I wish I could explain more. You know what, Mario? Maybe you should come on and do a live stream with me. Like, join the live stream and if you want to talk about it. You're more than welcome to send me a message on Twitter or if you're on Facebook, find me and we can start communicating if you're interested in doing something like that. I'm looking to add guests and do more roundtables and stuff too. So, all right, let's go. I danced to this, so. All right. Here we go. Bye, you guys. Have a great weekend.
What you preach, but you turn the other cheek. Yeah.